Welcome to the session on research and publication ethics. As we all know, any scholar or any student who is into research or who is aspiring to do research has to be aware of the ethical principles which needs to be followed while doing research or while publishing the output of the research. So today in this session we are trying to discuss about the various ethical principles which needs to be followed while doing research as well as publishing the output of our research. So as we all know, to know about all these things or to have a detailed study about all these things, let's have a glance on the real scenario of scientific research. As we all know, the entire structure of scientific research is built on basically on three pillars: academic integrity, publication ethics, as well as responsible conduct. But what is happening to these three pillars nowadays? That is the major focus of today's discussion. There is a huge deterioration of research in the academic integrity. There is increased incidence of compensatory publication ethics, as well as there is a lot of misconducts happening in the area of publication, like plagiarism, mushrooming of predatory journals, etc. So this has become a growing global concern, contaminating or polluting the entire domain of academic research, and India is no exception. So to know more about the responsible conduct as well as the research integrity in our higher education system, we need to know exactly the vastness, the complexity, as well as the diversity of the Indian higher education system. As we all know, UGC, the University Grants Commission, is the statutory organization which is responsible for the maintaining the standard of teaching, evaluation, as well as research in our country. And we are following exactly now, even now we are following the British system of affiliating system in our higher education system. Though it is going to be, soon it is going to be changed, still now we are following the affiliating system in our universities. And by and large, we have around more than 4 lakh colleges dealing with undergraduate courses, and around 900 universities are entrusted with postgraduate and research. And it is so proud, and we are so proud to say that according to the All India Survey on Higher Education, which was held in 2018, it is reported that about 1.285 million teachers are training around 36.6 million students. It's a big number. And around 4.14 million students are in master's program and 1,61,000 in doctoral programs. And it is so proud to say that around 34,400 students are being awarded PhD degrees every year, and 10,000 research fellowships are given every year by our government for the research scholars. And again, with immense pleasure, I need to say that according to the Scopus data, we have more than 1,47,537 articles being published from India. And obviously it is from the laboratories. Actually it is being published from our IIMs, IITs and research developed laboratories, and as well as from universities and colleges also. But again, we have a report in 2014 by the Nature Index Analysis, which is showing that 51% of our faculty members and 32% of doctoral students are authors of predatory journals. So in one hand, we are saying that we have a lot number of very good publications from the reputed institutions in India, though the number is too great, but we could find that we have lots of publications which come under predatory journals. So it is a very pathetic situation as far as research integrity is concerned. And it is also mentioned that 51% of predatory journals or predatory authors were from affiliated colleges, whereas 18% from private universities. Again, we have 15% from state universities. And in total, around 8,000 predatory journals are churning out more than 4 lakh items each year. This is a huge number which need not be happened. So, actually we need to say that predation as well as deception is being carried out in our Indian higher education research system, and we need to say that these are growing like coronavirus in the academic arena. So it was due to these conditions that UGC has come up with care journals in order to curtail or to avoid such predatory issues, or predatory to bring curtail to the predatory journals. But still we could find that there are so many things happening because research scholars are not aware of the various predatory journals or the various publication ethics or research ethics which need to be carried out while doing research. So now we shall discuss what are the responsible conducts which needs to be followed while doing research or while publishing a paper. So as we know, we do research. After the research, we need to get it published. Otherwise, making of research has no meaning, because once you get the output of the research, it should be publicized in the global context. So your publication or the research output get publicized in the global scenario. So how to get published in the global scenario? What are the contexts which needs to be followed while doing the research or while starting the research so that your output get published in a very good journal? So that we can now discuss what are the responsible contexts to be followed while doing research. So first one is the COPE, that is the Committee on Publication Ethics. We need to understand what a COPE is. That is the Committee on Publication Ethics. Actually, COPE is an international forum for editors as well as the publishers of peer-reviewed journals that provide the code of conduct as well as the best practices guidelines that defines the publication ethics and advises the editors on how to handle cases of research and publication misconducts. If there is any misconduct happening in the publication as well as the research being undertaken, that particular misconduct will not be allowed by the Committee of Publication Ethics. So they have written so many guidelines, or they have their own principles written in a format which is being used by the editors as well as the authors of reputed journals. So based on these guidelines, we have to put forward our research output. So if you are going to publish a data, or if you are going to publish a paper, first you need to submit the paper to the editor of the journal. So that editor will review your paper based on the guidelines given in the Committee on Publication Ethics. So he or she will ask you to give all the details of regarding these particular things. So we shall look into one by one what are the guidelines which are being put in the Committee on Publication Ethics, so that this particular paper is being taken by the editor for publication. So first, when you start your research, please do go and read the various guidelines which are given on the Publication Ethics Committee, by the Publication Ethics Committee. Actually, this is being given in almost all the reputed or international journals. They are given all the guidelines regarding how to publish a paper. So whenever you start a research, whenever you start with a research problem, please do check all the guidelines which is given in the Publication Ethics, so that you can have an ethical research done which will be published in a very good reputed journal. The first thing is about the Institutional Review Board, that is the IRB. So every university or every institution will have an Institutional Review Board who will review the various research proposals given to the particular university. So that review board will consist of a small number of people, selected academicians. They will be in the IRB group. So once you propose a research proposal. You can submit the research proposal before the IRB. The IRB persons, they will evaluate the proposal, and if they find that it is feasible or if it is good for doing, if it is good to continue with the research, they will approve your research. And if there is any, if they find that it is not at all good enough, or if there is no feasibility of the study, they will disapprove your study right at the initial stage itself. And if there is a chance of reviewing or making it corrected, then they will ask you, or they will put some review comments in the proposal and ask you to make the necessary corrections, and then you can again submit to the IRB board so that again they will review and will get it approved. So this is how an IRB board of a university works. Actually, it is an administrative body established to protect the rights and welfare of human research subjects recruited to participate in research activities conducted under the auspices of the institution with which it is affiliated. For example, when you if you are dealing with human samples, like if you are dealing for scholars from education or some biological research and all, they will be dealing with psychology, they will be dealing with human samples. So if you have human samples, then the institutional review board has to ensure that this particular research has followed all the protocols which is being introduced as part of human sample research. So they will ensure that all these things are being done, then only they will give approval for this particular research. So this is how it works. So it may take mainly the IRB committee may consist of 5 or 6 members, can be up to 10 members if possible. So at least one member should whose primary concern are in the areas of scientific areas. So scientific experts should be there, subject experts should be there, administrative persons should be there, then even and sometimes from judging, from the field of legal ethics, one person will be there. So these all will constitute the IRB group or the institutional review board group. So once your proposal is being agreed or being approved by the IRB, then you can go on with your research. So after completing your research, when you go for publishing it in a journal, in a Scopus indexed journal, the first thing they will ask is that you need to give an approval, or you need to show the IRB approval to the editor. They will ask to submit your IRB approval before reviewing that particular paper. So if you have not done this IRB approval, what happens is that after finishing all the research activities, analysis, everything, and writing the paper, if you go to publish this paper, what happens is that the editor will not let you to get it reviewed because you haven't completed the IRB process. So after completing the research, you will not be able to do the IRB process again. So please make sure that before starting your research, you need to get your IRB approval done. So what I will be able to share one of my experiences which happened in my life. Actually, when I was doing my postdoctoral study, I did a research which was simultaneously done in the Bahirdar University in Ethiopia and as well as in University of Kerala. And as far as Bahirdar University is concerned, I already got the IRB approval, everything done, because my collaborator there, the professor, did everything done. He was aware of all these things and he did all the formalities which has to be done well in hand or well in advance for the research. But what happened to myself was that I was unaware about the IRB process which should be happened in the University of Kerala, and at that time I was not here also, I was abroad, I was in US. So I didn't get the IRB approval from University of Kerala. So after completing the research which was done simultaneously in Bahirdar University and University of Kerala, we started trying to publish it. So my paper with respect to the Bahirdar University, it got published because it has all the approval, everything done well in advance. But when I went for publishing my research data, which happened to be collected or which analysis was been made from the University of Kerala, means my sample was students of higher education. That particular study, since I didn't get the IRB approval from University of Kerala, and also my sample was from the human specimen, I was not able to get it published because my I couldn't show the IRB approval to the concerned editor. So this is how it goes. So please try to ensure that well in advance before starting your research. So if you have human samples or some restrictions in your research proposal, submit your research proposal to the concerned IRB, Institutional Review Board, either to the university or to the research center. You have to submit it and get approval from the IRB so that everything will happen in the right manner. Next is the human and animal right. That, as I told you earlier, if you are dealing with, if your specimen or the sample is a human or an animal, you need to get the approval from the IRB. That means you need to have approval based on the guidelines which is written in the Committee of Publication Ethics, because in the COPE they have written that when reporting experiments on human subjects, authors should indicate whether the procedures followed were in accordance with the ethical standards of the responsible committee on human experimentation and with the Helsinki Declaration. So the IRB or the Institutional Review Board should sanction that our particular proposal is being done based on the human experience, being based on the Helsinki Declaration. All the guidelines which are given in the Helsinki Declaration is being followed in the particular research proposal or research experimentation which involves either a human or animal. So all the rights, all the human rights as well as the ethical, as well as the animal rights have to be followed. So the manuscripts reporting studies involving human participants, human data or human tissue must include a statement on ethics approval and consent. So you should have to produce the consent form that it follows the Helsinki Declaration. This is to be submitted along with your proposal for publication to the editor, and it should also include the name of the ethics committee that approved the study and the committee's reference number if appropriate. That's the thing I told you before. During the Institutional Review Board committee exercise, they will be reviewing whether your proposal has followed this Helsinki Declaration. If it has followed the Helsinki Declaration, they will give you the consent form that based on the Helsinki Declaration everything has been followed in the research proposal, so this proposal is approved. This particular consent form has to be submitted along with the your publication report, means your research paper. Along with the paper, you have to submit this also to the editor. So the editor will be convinced that this particular paper or this research is done in accordance with the Helsinki Declaration. And when reporting experiments on animals, also authors should be asked to indicate whether the institutional and national guide for the care and use of laboratory animals was followed. So no manuscript will be considered unless this information is supplied. If you can check any journal, any Scopus indexed journal, you could find that they have clearly written that no manuscripts will be considered unless this information regarding the Helsinki Declaration or human sample or animal is being supplied. So this is a very important thing. So well before starting your research, you need to get your IRB process done along with the human and animal rights. And the next thing which we need to understand or we need to submit along with our research report is the conflict of interest. that is a conflict of interest is nothing but it is a cornerstone of science is that it should be objective and unbiased. We know that any research which is to be done, it should be unbiased and it should be objective also. It should not be subjective. Suppose a researcher could gain financially or career-wise if he or she gets a particular result from a study. We know that many studies will earn you career as well as financial outputs. Yes. So if there is any possibility of such thing in your study, although it is by itself is acceptable, some people might doubt whether such consideration has compromised your study. Sometimes this may have compromisation, that is, some sponsors will be giving you funding for doing research, and there may be chances that these sponsors or these funding agencies may intervene in your study. So the result of your study may get manipulated. So the editors or the reviewers will have a chance. They will sometimes may have a chance to find that whether there is any chance of misappropriation which has taken place in this particular research. So in order to show that there is no such a type of manipulations or misappropriations happened in your study, you need to show a consent form showing conflict of interest. That is, when an author or the institution of the author has a relationship, financial or otherwise, with individuals or organizations that could influence the author's work inappropriately, a conflict of interest may exist. So you need to submit a form showing that there is no conflict of interest or there occurred no conflict of interest while doing this project. If there is a conflict of interest, it is called the competing interest. So we need to make sure to the editor that there is no conflict of interest happened in these areas of research. Again, another thing which you need to submit along with your paper, along with your research paper, is the informed consent. As we all know, we'll be having a huge sample, or we'll having a sample, either it can be a human sample or something else. But we need to, if it is a human sample, we need to get the informed consent from the sample. It is very important. So before the data collection with the human sample, you need to get the informed consent. So each journal will have their own type of, they will give you the informed consent, how the informed consent should be, or you will be having a structured informed consent sheet which can be given to the sample well in advance. So that particular informed consent should let them know what all things you are collecting. That means if your manuscript contain any individual person's data in any form, including any individual's details, images or videos, consent for publication must be obtained from that person, or in the case of children, their parent or legal guardian. All presentations of case reports must have consent for publication. Actually, that participant or the sample must have the right to know the purpose of your data collection. So you, well in advance, before the data collection, in your tool, you should write what is the purpose of your data collection, why and how they were selected to participate, why you are selected for this particular study. So that should be known to that particular sample. The time commitment involved, they choose to participate. How their data will be handled in terms of confidentiality or anonymity. Many times we need to tell them that this particular data will be kept confidential. So it is to be known by them, and they need to confirm that I agree to this particular data collection. So we must get the agreement from them regarding all these things. Also, the participation is voluntary and no negative consequences will come to them should they choose not to participate. Also, how they can withdraw at any time from the study. So now, as we all know, data is more expensive than any other things nowadays. We know that information information is the information or data is the most important or most expensive material. So each data of each individual is very expensive. So we need to make or ensure them that their data will be kept confidential and they can withdraw from this particular study at any time they intend to, or if they can, it is nothing, it is voluntary, there is no compulsion for them to join that study. All these things should be done well in advance in a consent form and should be get signed by the sample. So when you submit a paper for publication to a journal, the editor will ask you for an informed consent which has been taken from your sample. Sometimes he may ask one consent form, sometimes he may ask all the consent form which has been which you have collected for the entire sample. So it depends, because if the editor thinks that there is some manipulations being done in the study, because they are well aware of, they will be very expertise in the subject and they will be very easy, it will be very easy for them to know whether there is any manipulation has been done in your data by looking at your analysis itself. So if they find something, they can ask for the informed consent and also all other details regarding this particular data. So at that time you can produce your informed consent to the concerned editor and all. So it is very important to get the informed consent to get your data published. And the next one is the availability of data and materials. As we said, the data which you collected from the sample, it is very important, and that raw data should be available, and all the materials which you have collected should be readily available with you. Because if the editor or if any of the reviewer ask you for the raw data, you should be able to produce that data at that time. And because sometimes the reviewer, if they have any confusion or something which regard to the analysis, or some mistake happened during the analysis, if they need any clarification, they might ask you to upload the entire raw data to the editor or the reviewer. At that time, if you have the entire data with you, there is no doubt, you can just upload that Excel sheet as such to the editor as well as the reviewer. So it is very important that your data and the materials should be readily available. All manuscripts must include an availability of data and materials statement. Data availability statement should include information on where data supporting results reported in the article can be found, including, where applicable, hyperlinks to publicly archived data sets and analyzed or generated during the study. I think now if you go to publish any paper, you could find that in the article, in the guidelines itself, they have given a particular link where you need to upload the entire data, so that complete data will be available to the entire public if anybody want to have a look onto it. So these are the context, or these are the responsible context which a scholar or which a researcher or anybody who is interested to do research have to follow while doing research, or have to follow while going for publishing their output of the research, that means publishing a paper.